put them at number two in the world rankings at this point, because I can't, I mean, Very Games for me were still going to finish second even with the sort of shoddy performances they've had. And Nexus have proved to be, you know, a shot in the arm.
They haven't dropped one game.
Yeah, I mean, you've seen it as well with the guys here that, you know, at Face It. We were a little bit despondent, much like a Counter-Strike team that takes, you know, a heavy drubbing on, say, you know, an even map. Yeah. That's how we kind of felt earlier in the afternoon. Now, as the games have picked up, and as, you know, everything's, all the issues have been worked out, and especially as the Nexus went through to the final, the morale just lifted like 200%.
And Jay, we got a live audience here in the studio now as well. The final is underway, it's live, and the knife round has already been done, so NIP will be starting on that CT. Jay.
Yep, distinct advantage. As you can see, the drop coming down onto site. So you're going to see a heavy upper rush. Headshots coming in. Two headshots from, that's going to be Freiburg and Exist. Get right with the return. Not before two kills come in from Anexis, though. And that's going to be the end of the round. It looks like a quick wipe out on that upper site. Almost like a Swedish eco there. I'm not quite sure what they're doing running out of the hut like that. They pretty much lined up for the headshots, didn't they?
Yeah, they did, but one of those weird things to do, really, in CS, like just going for that fast push on that upper bomb side. It can be phenomenal, and you can pretty much win a flawless round as a team.
To be honest, I can see where they were coming from, because the new nuke, of course, it's got all that cover in the middle.
A lot of cover in the middle.
If you get to the right-hand side of that cover, you are protected from top ladder, pretty much, so I can see where they were coming from, but obviously NIP know the counters of that, and it's just rushed straight back at hut itself. So
indeed.
That's exactly what it did. Now we do see the gun run here, formality of the eco bash coming in. It's going to be kills coming left, right and centre. Now good nade over the top from Get Right. That's going to drop Pimps. That's a key kill. Obviously Pimps, even with just a Glock, is a distinct threat. Now we're going to see the final kills coming in here. And that's going to be a 2-0 scoreline. So standard play here on the CT side. You would normally expect a 10-5 scoreline. Would you agree with that?
10-5 is something I would be thinking it would be if it was 1.6 of source. But the addition, or I should say the change of the entry point to lower from outside in the yard, done by Volcano, by the way, from the US, I think it's going to change up what the balance of the map, really. But I don't think people have learned to utilize it as much as you can do. So I would say
that will come in time, though.
10-5 is still a standard for DE nuke, yeah, Jay.
I think it's slightly less 10-5 than it would have been on 1.6 or source, but still, yeah, slightly 10-5.
Bifloren with that four kill does not pick up that last kill, because Freiburg comes in and says, no, you're not getting that, the first ace of the grand final, because obviously Faber wants that for himself, doesn't he?
Yep, well, you can't blame him. I mean, obviously at this point now, you're trying to get those numbers posted up on the eco bash, so it looks better when you come to the end. So
yeah.
Whatever kills you can pick up, it's not like, you know, bum rushing against two guys with Glocks when you've got an assault rifle, isn't that hard to do? So, especially when you're an IP, I mean, they do have the skills to pay the bills at the end of the day, so I'm not going to sweat against any eco from any team in this tournament. Now we have seen an aggressive upper rush, first gun round of the first half of the grand finals. Pimps and Nico and MSL picking up kills. That's going to be a hat-trick of frags with no return from NIP, so advantage to your terrorists here. As you can see, Fifth Laren's been forced all the way into the vents. He's hoping for a drop. It's not going to happen. He's now forced himself up onto the site. Picks up the M4 frag. MSL returns the favor with the AK-47, 7.62 rounds to the face.
Oh,
I mean, I can see a terrible nade, but nobody taking a huge amount of damage from that. So it's kind of unfortunate that whoever it was in front of Nico decided they was going to jump, but oh well. As you can see, it looks like we're going to see Get Right on the save here. Let's just drop the perspective onto him. It looks like he's going to try and set up here to just keep hold of that M4. Obviously the right thing to do here, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, and I don't think Anexis really should be hunting for this weapon. NIP will have to go on to an eco after this. Having that M4 might change the balance and the outcome of that round, but Anexis has lost three rounds in a row and just bought weapons. They don't really want to throw away their AKs just yet. That hunting of the last gun is something you would do a bit later in the game, to be honest.
Yeah. I mean, it's not essential at this point, obviously, and Anexis do want to build up some kind of stack on the cash here where they can start to then, you know, not sweat about losing the odd round here and there, which obviously on the T side is going to happen. Now, of course, with Get Right having that M4, do you think they're going to base a strat around his M4? Do you think they're going to stick him on ramp with maybe a three-man stack or something special like that?
Well, yeah, seeing NIP now, actually, they have got a lot of nades on them. So they are looking to take this round, Jade. It's not a normal eco for them.
No,
they've got something special planned here. Yeah, they even bought for this. So that's going to be... let's see if that works out for them, Jay. I mean, if they lose out this round, they're going to be pretty in a bad condition.
That's true, yeah. They're going to be absolutely flat broken and calling the receivers in there. Nico going to grab that AK-47 headshot, so good start. MSL also picking up a kill. just did manage to grab a frag in between as Forrest picks up the M4 frag onto MSL. We're going to see the AK return onto Forrest though from top ladder. And you can see the bomb site being slightly overwhelmed here. The bomb is going to go down. 3-on-2 situation. The health in favour of... I suppose if you did the totals, it would be just in favour of ANEXIS, but the two guys that are low here could be dropped by just, you know, pretty much harsh language. Fifth Laren does know there's somebody at the right side of the CT vent. He is going to be dropped by the AK.
Get right, guys! Huge!
Oh my god, that was... If Get Right needed to pull out the frags and go clutch, that would be the moment to do it, and he does come up with the goods. So, all you Get Right fanboys out there, there's something for you to make a frag clip out of and stick all your After Effects on. That was impressive, man.
And why do I even get surprised that that happens? When I see him going up that ladder, I should like immediately know that this is going to happen.
Automatically know default loss of Nexus, but no. To be honest, you're never going to get... As good as Get Right is, you can never expect him to clutch in a situation like that on a regular basis. Even though he does manage to do it on a regular basis. It's just too much to ask, you know, but he does still manage to pull off these clutches. So,
phenomenal.
Huge fanboy of Get Right. I know I shouldn't be because I'm a commentator, but it's hard not to have a man crush on somebody who can do that to a free man up a rush. Now we have seen Get Right again picking up double frags with the M4, and again another hat trick. That's 6 frags in 2 rounds here. The only performance I've seen like that in you know, that's made me fanboy as hard was KF3 at the DreamHack Summit that I was talking about.
KF3?
Yeah.
Really?
All school.
Norwegian.
And he did pick up, it was 3 5 mans in a row. And I suppose Get Right could have a better all around performance as KF3 did drop off in that game, but. I can see Get Right here leading the way for his team and really putting Nexus on the back foot on Nuke. Now, Nuke obviously is one of NIP's stronger maps. If they do get sort of like a grip on you on that CT side, they're not going to give up. They're going to press that dominance, and they're going to make sure they convert the economic control into runs, aren't they?
Yeah, I totally agree with what you're saying. And the fact that Get Right just picked up, first of all, that 1v3 clutch and then picks up another hat trick, he is going to be so pumped for this game, man. And even though he's a stable player and everything, I mean, he's going to thrive so much off of that, Jay.
Oh, yeah, his adrenaline is definitely going off of that. I mean, a lot of people don't understand that, you know, the adrenaline that comes from playing at this level and there's this kind of money up for grabs. If you can't control the adrenaline, it can be a hindrance, though, can it?
Yeah, obviously. If you start getting picked off every single round, you kind of need to... you always have to have your emotions in control, really, as a professional gamer or any athlete, really. It all comes out to you have to have good and bad days, but you never really have to think too much about it.
Just you gotta have
focus
the same. You gotta have the same mindset.
Focus on the game.
Yeah. It's got to be focus, and really, Get Right is one of those players. Even if the adrenaline is pumping and his heart rate's up, it's not gonna affect his playstyle really.
No.
Now, as you can see, standard setup here. We got the second gun round of the first half. And we are seeing, third gun round of the first half, I should say. We are seeing a Nexus with the AWP on Nico, so they're gonna be looking to create the openings here from that AWP. T-side, I'm not a big fan of having that AWP unless he's going to pick outside or ramp, to be honest. If they are going to go for the upper strats, it's not much use, is it, really? I mean, it's as much use as a chocolate fire guy, to be honest.
No, I totally agree. You need to use that towards ramp, and then you can use it on lower side and get that AWP to stand on ramp and pretty much cover the entire site with it. But other than that, if you're not going to utilize it, I think it's a bit of a waste to have an AWP on the T-side, to be honest, yeah.
Now, as you can see, we got Glaive here. He's pushing in from outside. He's going to take a lot of M4 fire from Forrest. That's going to bring it back to a 4-on-4. The health and the bomb still in the favour of ANEXIS here, though. So they could still force the situation here and make this an interesting round. 6-1 the current score with 35 seconds left on the clock. We are going to see Nico and company make that move through ramp room. So chance that they could put this all to good use here. But as you can see, we've got Fifth Laren just at the other side. He is going to be spammed down, though. That was an exceptional play from ANEXIS. It seems like they'd anti-stratted the vent guard in there. Forrest and Get Right going to reply with 2 M4 headshot, and in fact an M4 and AK headshot. Bomb is going to go down here, but I think we're going to see basically a good old-fashioned retake. We do have grenades in reserve, and as you can see, it looks like... that could have been tragic.
A little bit of miscommunication there, but it's fine. He had a little bit of a bad aim there, so it's good.
To be honest, I think he actually did pull it at the last second. I think his most finger was on the way, but I think his hand moved it just because. Now, Nico is going to put that AWP to good use, defending from ramp, as Walkline did point out, would be the optimal position to actually hold down the vents here. See, second frag from Nico. This is working in their favour, and it's going to be the second round on the board for ANEXIS. That comes at a pivotal time as well, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. They have to start picking up rounds early, as Threat has said multiple times during this event as well. Rounds can easily slip from you at any given stage. You can feel slip into a comfortable zone, really, where you think you're untouchable, and oh, now we can get those rounds later, but it's just like in a matter of a second, the game's already over. So
yeah, again, I mean, hubris is a big part of Counter-Strike. If you do get too cocky, especially against a team like ANEXIS, you could find yourself being crushed in no shot order, but NIP are a different beast altogether, so I don't think you are going to see them get too overconfident here. Now, as you can see, NIP pushing radio. We got a good nade into Squeaky. Oh,
a little bit of team flash there.
I think it actually made it out of ramp, so no harm, no foul. But we are seeing ANEXIS all over the upper site now.
Nico. He will probably get. Oh, he misses that shot. That's a,
he's
that's
in a vulnerable
a bit of a surprise,
position,
Jay.
No. Yep, he's in a vulnerable position here, but he's called in the rotation from Squeaky, so he should be safe here. He just have to dig in a little bit and. I assume that's going to be. Is it going to be Get Right? Who's no? It's not going to be Get Right. Actually, push through. Oh,
Fifron is going to push this.
Oh, okay. Well, he's going to push it. And he's going to be dropped. So that's now going to make it a 4-on-1 here. So we should see the second round in a row go over to the Danes. And I have to say, I'm pleasantly surprised if they can stack up 5 rounds here on this T side, despite losing, you know, side choice. They still in with a heavy shot in the first map, aren't they?
Yeah, but I have to say, I'm quite surprised that Fifron's choice at pushing in. They're like Fifron's probably like one of his best qualities is. Playing on brains, really. He's a really smart player, and having already lost a round, giving away his weapon this round, which they're obviously going to lose, it's not really a smart thing. So that's probably the first time I've criticized Kiflarn or any of his choices. So a bit weird, but Forest picks up a kill, MSL finishes off, and it's 6-63 here in favor of Ninjas in Pyjamas.
I think a lot of that was Fiflarn being baited in by the fact that Nico had the AWP in the Squeaky Room, and he thought, well, I might be able to get some cash damage done here, which is going to prove to be important as the game stretches out, of course, in the first half, but really He was baited in because, as I pointed out, basically Nico called in the rotation from the upper side to guard Squeaky. He had the angles covered, and really there was no option there but other than taking AK shots to the chest and being dropped. Now we are seeing a somewhat light buy here. We got FAMASes in play. At some point, do you think we're going to see Nip pick up the AWP here, or do you think it's just going to be all rifles across the board?
I think they will use an AWP during this game. Yeah, I just think they don't have the economy for it just now. Kind of want to build up a solid bank account before utilizing that off, because obviously it's a huge investment which can pay dividends, but if you lose it and don't utilize it, it's going to cost you a lot of money.
Yeah, and even worse than that, sometimes you can give it straight up to your opponent.
Yeah, which is double the worth, like double the loss of it. So right, not a lot of stuff going on here. We see some flashes going down now, so the push
flashes
is imminent.
Yep. Here we go. We should be seeing the move here from Nexus. Nexus taking a lot of fire though. Nico coming through ramp. It's going to be Nilly who was dropped there on the ramp entry. So Get Right now shifting to outside. He's going to check for the flank here. It's not going to happen for him though. I do see who's that going to be off in the distance. Can't actually read because of the X-ray mode text being so small. Definitely MSL, because MSL's made his entrance to the upper site. He's going to be shut down by Exist, though. The headshot coming in. Freiburg with the backup as well with that FAMAS. It's a bomb down. Forrest with the FAMAS headshot, and that's going to be Freiburg for the final kill with the FAMAS. And we are seeing that upper site push just completely mopped up here by NIP. It wasn't even a case of they had superior position there. It was just superior aim, wasn't it?
Yeah, just purely outplayed, really. And not really that surprised seeing NIP kind of outplay ANEXIS from time to time. ANEXIS doing the wise thing here, going on to that eco. I see Glaive have picked up a couple of flashbangs and a smoke grenade. So
see where Glaive is actually going here, because is Glaive going to go? Yeah, he's going for the skylight flashes. So straight through the skylight windows now.
Yeah,
that's going to be smokes and flashes onto site. So that could very well be the opening here, as we can see the push out now. Forrest can hold up the AK-47. 2 kills coming in for Forrest. Make that a hat trick of kills. Is he going to get the George Foreman? No, he's going to be dropped. He was trying to leap around the cover. Doesn't matter, because Get Right comes with the hero play, picks up the final kill. MSL gets dropped, and that's now going to be a scoreline of 8-3 in favor of the Swedes. Now, looking at your scoreboard, your top scorer so far is going to be, of course, Get Right after his back-to-back hat tricks in the, I think it was the fourth and fifth round, wasn't it?
Yeah.
He's now on 13-2. So obviously the old bank balance here. I think they're going to be looking at perhaps opening up, an investment bank at some point, NIP, because they do have a ton of cash reserves at this point. Let's put you back on auto director so we don't miss anything. It looks like we've got a bit of a split here coming on. It just seems like ANEXIS just trying to feel for a weak spot here, which they're not really going to find, are they?
No, I'm just having a look outside quick to see how Nico just utilizes that AWP, and he didn't manage to do much on that outer side, so he's just pulling back in now with his teammates, probably looking towards pushing that upper bomb site. From what I see one of the ANEXIS players getting ready on top of the T roof to put down some flashes. If that's for faking or if it's actually for the push, we'll see soon.
Well, looks like it's going to be for the push. As squeaky as pop. Two men come out of pop as well. Freiburg going to get a hat trick of M4 headshots. Beautifully done. I mean, Warclone, how much of a game changer is it when you've got two players such as Get Right and Fifth Laren, who is so on form at the moment?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty much everyone, isn't it? Like Freiburg, Fifth Laren, Get Right, and then you see the two other ones who hasn't really done those good clutches yet. It's Exist and Forest, and you know you can rely on these two players any day of the week, really. Yep. So
I mean, Forest is still, you know, he's still got 14 frags in the ball for just 6 deaths, so it's not like he's dropped off here, and he is putting a great performance. It's just he's not had any of those moments like Get Right's had, so he's not stood out as of yet.
Here we go, Exist.
Spray down coming in from Exist. Get Right going to steal one of his frags, though. He's going to count as an assist, and it's going to be a complete just Swedish eco. No real damage done. Only 21 HP removed from the whole of NIP, and now we are seeing a 10-3 scoreline. So in order to be in the shout here, I think ANEXIS have to pick up the next 2 rounds. Would you agree?
Yeah, I totally agree. If ANEXIS doesn't get at least 4 rounds, the game is already over. But if you get only 4 rounds as well, it's going to be such an upward spell when you go over to the easier side of the map. If you lose that pistol round, you're going to be so demotivated, knowing that you only have one more round to kind of lose before putting it into... Yeah,
no margin for error whatsoever if they do finish up with the scoreline as it is right now. They need these last 2 rounds. Now, obviously, cash is not going to be an issue because they've lost quite a few straight here, so they will be able to buy. But just because you can buy doesn't mean you're going to outclass NIP. Now, we are seeing a good drop here from MSL. They've managed to take advantage of Freiburg looking on their defense, and we are seeing Nilly coming up from lower as well. If Lauren does pick up a consolation headshot here, so it's a 4-on-3. Still, I would have to say, because NIP are so good at moving around and actually adjusting, probably still advantage NIP here because of the CT bias. Would you agree?
Well, yeah, I think it's pretty much 50-50 at this stage. What's surprising to me is both of the kills that has been taken onto the NIP squad has been backstabs where they haven't had their teammates covering their backs. And that's quite surprising to me, seeing NIP failing on pretty much basic teamwork there.
Oof, good nade hits exist. That's going to take away, drop into 267, and he takes a bullet to drop into 40, but still not going to stop him from dropping Nico down the outside. So good frags being exchanged. That's going to bring it back to level pegging, free a piece here. Bomb is going down on the upper site, and as we can see, Spray coming into Forest. He's going to try and sneak in through Squeaky, but alas, Nilly did have his angle covered there on Squeaky, so not able to even get in on site. As you can see, Glaive controlling top ladder here, and this does look like it is going to be a Nexus round. I think they've got the superior position, and the bomb's ticking away. They've got high control here. Now, Fifth Laren is going to move in. He's going to grab himself the headshot, so 2-on-1 here. He could clutch it. Let's drop our spotlight on him. Looks like, no, he's going to decide that... Oh, no, he's actually going back in. He was faking the squeaky retreat there, but perhaps he should have retreated. Then again, it's not like NIP are going to have any kind of, you know, cash troubles here.
No, I mean, he did the right choice there, seeing as what we just talked about, ANEXIS needing that fourth and probably fifth round here. So Fifth Laren going in for that 1v2 after getting that one kill. Totally legit. Unfortunately, it didn't really pay off for him, but... I mean, you can't really be that careful and just go saving every time you're against more opponents, really.
No, I completely agree with that. As we can see, Fifth Laren spraying down into ramp and from ramp into radio. Not connecting with anyone, but it lets them know that he's at least there. As we can see, I'm going to put the Alpha Director back on so we can catch up with the action that's going down. A lot of posturing for position here. Nobody taking any damage so far. Now, Pimps is in a position to pick up a kill, and he does. Does manage to drop Freiburg on the exit from Squeaky after a good flashbang. And we're going to see Glaive also grab a headshot. Back to a 3-on-2. Make that a... Commentators kiss of death there. As soon as I say 3-on-2, it drops to a 3-on-1. And Nexus moving in with Nico. Now, Nico is probably the player who could clutch here, but it's one thing to clutch against Very Games. It's a completely different thing to clutch against the likes of NIP. So, good house being exchanged, an 11-4 scoreline. Pistols going to be devastatingly important now to the CTs of ANEXIS, aren't they?
Yeah, I mean, losing if they lose the pistol and then the 2 eco switches following, I mean, they're 1 round away from match point, really.
Yeah.
So it's you can't really underestimate the importance of this round that we're about to see. So I'm hoping we will see something special come out of the ANEXIS team and not just the standard setup from CTs, really.
Yeah.
But it's a bit of a risk, though.
I'm hoping what we will see is exactly what Very Games did to ANEXIS. Maybe they've learned from that, and we are going to see, you know, a radio and a hot posh. Yeah. That's going to establish exactly where NIP are going, because obviously, as you know, as Fret has pointed out numerous times on Nuke, Nuke is one of those maps where establishing where they're actually going allows you to make that early rotation, and it allows you to completely decimate any push that's coming in. Because usually, if it is going to be you know, something you have to rotate to, it's going to be a lower drop. And obviously, if you can get control of those vents before they get anywhere near, that's going to make actually getting guys into position for defusal so much easier. Now, we are going to see the opening of the first half here. Sorry, of the first round, the second half, I should say. Pistol round underway. 11-4 the current scoreline. NIP seem to be just playing the clock down a little bit here. They're looking for the initial opening. It looks like they are going to be spamming top ladder, but as you can see, Glaive using the window room here. He's going to open up with the Glock. Sorry, not the Glock, that was the USP, actually. It was the USP that he had.
Yeah, and NIP are moving towards that lower bomb set with... four members of the squad just slowly pushing these hallways. They're just trying to find a defensive CT here, but they can't really find anyone. But they will know that there's at least one CT in those vents. Forrest obviously on top of that one, checking ramp as well, jumping into dark spot. Can't really find anyone, and that's never a good feeling, really.
Ooh, just the most inopportune time there for Nui to actually look away from Freiburg's push into ramp room. And that split second, he was looking in the right direction, but I mean, just threw his crosshair off where it would have been a perfect headshot. Now, double frags in the vents. Did he even get a triple? No, he could get the knife kill. Oh, he gets one stab. Are we going to see it? Yes! Macho man exist, I've got to say. That was impressive.
What?
Sick mode engage. And, well, exist with the highlight of the tournament so far for my money. That was monster.
I mean, one thing is ANEXIS lost that pistol round, but what a way to lose it, being two of your members being knifed. I mean, they must feel decimated. They have no chance. I'm calling right now, no chance of getting back into this game. It's going to be pretty much 16-4 here, Jay. Don't you agree?
I do agree, actually. That's the sort of thing that if they weren't demoralized after an 11-4 first half, losing two knife kills is definitely going to push them over the edge. So, next two runs should go the way of NIP, obviously in the form of the default eco bashing. And that should make a scoreline of 14-4. So hopefully ANEXIS can get a few runs on the board and make it a bit more respectable, because obviously, you know, people tend to see 14-4 and they start to think, NIP has got this in the bag, I can go and do something else. Obviously, Inferno, I think, is going to be a much closer affair.
A lot closer. It's not as biased as this map, but it's probably what you were going on about there before I just interrupted you. Sorry about that.
That's like a buddy. You have a point to make, so feel free to make it. As you see, MSL though, with the shotgun headshots, an extra $900 onto MSL. That could force the early buy here, but I don't know if that's a good idea. I mean, obviously, we've got Galil's in play, so we could actually... In fact, he's got two kills on that, so that definitely is going to force the early buy. An extra $1,800. There's a chance here that they could actually pick up the victory. I mean, it is a 5-on-3, but I'd be very surprised if they did with just CT pistols to work with here.
Yeah, and to be honest, I think they really need to just gamble a little bit, so an early buy would actually make sense for me right now. Forrest picks up that kill onto Nico, so it's down to a 4v3 here now. Make that a 3v3, Jay.
3v2. Advantage nip for the first time in a long time in the second eco bash. First eco bash, I should say. We are seeing Forrest spraying down onto that door. The bomb has gone down here, so it's going to be a nice crossfire setup. You can see he's covering the window. This should be a kill here. Nilly's going to pop up. He's going to take the AK-47 to the face any second. I can feel it. If not from Exist, then obviously from Forrest. He's doing well to actually prolong this as long as he has, but as you see, there's the crossfire, and it was beautifully set up by an MP. They had basically right angle crossfire setup. That's just about the hardest crossfire to deal with apart from a 180, of course. Anything beyond, you know, 90 degrees, obviously going to be harder than 90 degrees to deal with, but in that situation, it was always going to be a loss, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, having a pistol against two guys with an AK an AK each, and as you pointed out, going into a crossfire is never really something you look forward to say the least.
Yeah, especially against players of that caliber.
Yeah.
Because you know they're going to coordinate the crossfire. It's not going to be like we have seen, you know, throughout the tournament here, where you've had moments on other teams where they've been pushing at the wrong time. You know, you've had guys broaching bomb sites when they shouldn't have been.
Yeah.
not going to be the case from NIP here. As you can see, NIP making the way into the ramp room. And they have taken some casualties here. They have dropped an AK. But to be honest, you should expect to see ANEXIS here do a lot of cash damage to this T-sides, even in the eco bashes, because it is that heavily CT-sided. Now, NIP going to be moving those AKs. Very smart play here. You do not want those CTs to get any weaponry.
If MSL gets into a great position for close combat, he's going to do a lot of damage with that shotgun, that Mag 7. And actually, he's in a great position. He picks up that kill onto Getrat. What an important kill. He gets the second one onto Exist. And Forrest is a bit afraid now because he knows there's a huge Mag 7 going around here. He's changed out that weapon for an AKJ, which I got to admit, it's a wise decision.
Yeah, especially if he's going to try and put some distance here between himself and Forrest. Now, Forrest opening up with the AK. Wow. He dropped. Beautiful move from MSL. He did have pimps coming down for the backup as well. There was also Glaive still alive as well. So really at this point now, that is a much needed run to make it 13-5. No, really the momentum is still going to be with NIP here. They are going to be able to buy because they're on that T side, of course. And it's not like they're buying AWPs either. So
no, exactly.
Cash is not going to be an issue here. Probably even going to be able to sneak in another buy after this, I think, if they go quiet for a light buy. You know, maybe who would be bottom fragging right now? It would be Fifth Laren, so maybe Fifth Laren on the Galil and everybody else on AKs with no grenades to back it up. But as you can see, Nico on the outside, he's looking for that, basically the Red Rock boost, and he does find it. That's going to be Forrest dropped. Exist moving down. This is really now the point where NIP, if they want to close this up in style, they've got to do it now. Now, Freiburg here on the boost, actually putting down some skylight fire. He did do some damage as well, so obviously, the new position where you can actually hit top ladder from that skylight boost does open up some new opportunities for T's who are on an actual, you know, a light buy or an eco, because if you can get that pick on top ladder,
yeah,
it then opens up the hot rush, and it means that you can take control of the upper bomb site quite easily.
Yeah, in CS Source you could actually do a three-man booster, so you could actually have a guy just pretty much.
But didn't they change that?
Yeah, you would glide.
Yeah, I was going to say, they changed that come the Orange Box update where you couldn't even do the three-man boost anyway.
No, okay, that's it. Yeah, that's true.
They did take that functionality out, which I was not a big fan of, because obviously from 1-6 you have a lot of three-man boost that required a lot of coordination and team play. So
Exist really just managed to get behind a member of ANEXIS here and has reduced that one-man advantage that ANEXIS had. And they will be able to plant that bomb on the lower site now. Let's see what ANEXIS can do to get back into this game.
A lot of fire coming in from NIP right now. Exist and Get, they're going to grab frags. Pimp's dropping down the vent. He's going to pick up an M4 kill. This is looking fairly promising here as they got the angles, and it's going to be a one-on-one. Two-on-one now. MSL and Pimps, I should say, taking on Fifth Laren here. And Fifth Laren does have the health advantage.
Oh, Fifth Laren! Oh!
Sick play. Decides to take out the diffuser first. Obviously, he was pretty close to getting the defusal, but normally you would see him go for the guy protecting first. Gutsy move, done with a pistol as well. Hats off to him.
I mean, already in this first map of the Grand Final, we're seeing some great plays coming out of both NIP and ANEXIS, especially MSL's Mag 7 play on ramp there. I quite fancied that one.
Yeah. Now, I did say in the very early stages of the tournament, even if NIP are going to, you know, blow out all the teams in this tournament, still a good showcase for them. They do play with a playstyle that's very entertaining. I mean, we've already seen what, two knife kills in one round, and obviously the little things in between. So, and ANEXIS haven't been out with our highlights as well. Obviously, with the like you say, the MP7 play. Obviously, stacking up, you know, $1,800 in a round, but when you eco against NIP, is always going to be, you know, it's always going to be entertaining. But it's probably not going to be enough here, is it, Walklan?
No, I don't think so. It's the scoreline reads 14-5. Obviously, ANEXIS do have some weaponry on them, but not a lot, really. MSL gets taken down here as Fifth Laren takes a team kill onto Forrest. ANEXIS gets two kills as well, and it's now down to 3v2 in favor of ANEXIS, but they've got Glaive only with that pistol, Jay. But they do have Nico on that great big AWP and pimp on that AK, so still it's anybody's round, really.
Well, I was going to say, here comes the bomb to top ladder. Nico is going to pick up Getright. Not quite sure what Getright was thinking there, not checking top ladder. He was looking towards lockers, which is, I suppose it's a valid spot to check, but 9 times out of 10 it's going to be top ladder, not lockers, unless it's been an outside push. Freiburg opening up with the AK-47, manages to grab the headshot onto Nico. That's a huge kill, that takes away that AWP. And really, at this point of the game, it's not like we can be afford to losing AWPs left, right, and center for this ANEXIS squad. So
we've got 10 seconds remaining on the clock. So Freiburg needs to start planting a bomb. And because of that...
that was a good fake.
It was indeed. But he's in a world of trouble. He's going to get that kill onto Glaive, but
I wasn't thinking about Freiburg's fake. I was more thinking about the actual fake from the CT coming out of Hutt.
Yeah.
Stop Freiburg's plant dead. And that was basically what secured that run.
But he kind of, he was a bit lucky with it as well, because Freiburg's flashbang hit him, and Freiburg therefore knew that there was someone there, and that's why he kind of got off that bomb plan, I think. So a bit of a luck of the draw, not draw of the luck, really. But he was planning to go out there to fake MJ, so totally legit comment.
Well, speaking of fakes, it looks like we are seeing perhaps a setup for a fake on the side here. We've got the smoke going out, but as you can see on the X-ray vision here, it does look like we are seeing an inside setup. So, wouldn't be surprised to see some heavy pressure put onto ramp here. Nip have somewhat neglected ramp so far. I mean, I'm kind of surprised that they haven't hit it as hard as they have in previous games. But I mean, when you're having success on the upper side like they're having right now, saying that, and ANEXIS got something to say about that. It's hard to justify going to ramp, I suppose, if you know you can shut them down on the other side, as we see Exist do with two kills there from AK47. Nearly coming from Vents, and he is going to pick up the final kill. That was a much-needed round here for ANEXIS. That's going to keep them in this game with a chance to, I suppose, you could say pick up a victory, but I'd say you've got more chance of getting poop from a rocking horse at this point, or blood from a stone, if you want a more sort of palatable analogy.
Now let's see, we've got NIP on the Nico here, no grenades or armor bought from them, so that's probably going to mean another round here for the Nexus, making it 14-8, and I mean, it's starting to look like a respectable scoreline for Nexus, really.
Yeah, I think if they can walk away with sort of 10 rounds on the board, that is perfectly acceptable. And it means that they can go into Inferno, which will be the second map, of course, with some modicum of confidence, I suppose. I mean, NIP are one of the stronger nuke teams out there in this day and age, so I wouldn't be too crestfallen about losing to NIP on Inferno, even if it was 16-7. I think they've done well considering they went into the second half. You know,
oh, you mean on
nukes? Yeah, so what did I say?
Oh, you said Inferno.
Oh, yeah. Right, yeah. Going into Inferno.
yeah, I know.
Now, Glaive with the M4 kill, that's going to be Exist dropped. This is the first round where we've seen ANEXIS in a dominant position for a long time. Now, Nico and Nilly going to pick up those two final kills. That's going to be Nip's outside push shut down, and we do see a 8th round on the board. So, getting close to that very respectful scoreline of 10 rounds on the board, which I think they can walk away from and be like, well, it's 10 rounds, you know. Yep. Could have been better, could have been worse. So let's have a look at your scoreboard. Take off the overview to do that. MSL is going to be in top place for ANEXIS. Now, the tail of the tape here really, really speaks louder than I ever possibly could. The fact that he's, you know, top fragging with 17 kills but 18 deaths lets you know just exactly what we've seen so far on Nuke. I mean, it has been fairly one-sided. What I will say is that NIP have been sort of reliant on a couple of people like Get Right to really put up those numbers.
Yeah.
But they can always fall back in other players to do the same as well.
Yeah, exactly. Let's see, we've got weapons from both teams now. And a lot of the rounds, Jay, has been pretty much trading back and forth all the way down to 1v1. So even though it's 14-8, I think it's been a lot of close rounds, which has gone... well, I mean, it's pretty much gone into 50-50, hasn't it?
Yeah, the 1 versus 1 rounds, I mean, they've been fairly closely contested. We've seen sort of an even split in those.
Yeah.
The rounds that NIP have won have usually been sort of like 3-1.
Yeah,
The rounds that ANEXIS won have usually been like 4-0.
Yeah.
So it's sort of standard CTP on Nuke. Freiburg on the entry into ramp, he's going to shut down Nilly. Looks like we are going to see Nico on the rotation from top, but he's also going to get shut down by Freiburg. And this has got to be game point now, hasn't it?
Yeah, it does look like it. Freiburg on fire here, kind of missing some shots there. Moving onto that lower bomb site, they have put Pimp down to 21 HP, really, and he's in a 1v3. Yeah, he's going for it. I was about to ask you what you would have done if you were in his position.
Here we go. Forrest, you evil man. The Hutt spam through two walls straight into the face. Probably only did about 120 damage after penetrating both of those walls, but 120 damage is 20 more damage than he's actually needed. So good job, Forrest. Just to reiterate what he was going to say, was it a good idea to go top ladder? I guess that's what he was alluding to. Most definitely. They knew that the drop had come in lower because they'd taken ramp. If you can take top ladder, it's much easier to hold than the lower site for my money, because you do have that elevation.
Yeah.
You can always fall back. You know, if you've got an A coming in, just drop down the ladder.
Yeah.
So it is a much more preferable site, but it's harder to take for my money. So if you can fake them out into lower and then go up when you've got that numerical advantage,
I completely agree.
Do it every time.
having that higher ground advantage there with being able to hide in that cage above the ladder is always going to be great for the terrorists. It's now 15-8, and MSL with that Mag 7 weapon of choice this game for MJ.
Yep, he's putting that shotgun to full use. The you can't really call it buckshot because there's no spread on it. I mean, it's like a railgun, but
yeah.
I guess it's firing solid slugs. Still a little bit OP for my taste, considering it is what is ostensibly an eco weapon.
But I just have to say that I really enjoy seeing a shotgun actually being used in competitive.
Yeah, I do quite like the mixture of weapons that we are seeing, because we are seeing some new weapons in rotation. Obviously, we've seen the Deagle become, deco rounds have become non-existent now. And rightfully so, considering it feels like you're a nerf coat whenever you fire the Deagle. Mm-hmm. So it's become far less useful, and it is pretty much a waste of $80.
Yeah, you even have some machine guns being used now.
Exactly,
obviously, MP5 being used a long, long time ago in both iterations of CS, but it kind of faded out at the end.
You would only ever use the MP5 if you were sort of disrespectful to your opponent, or if you was getting absolutely drummed, and you were sort of forced onto very, very light buys. So the fact that it's used as a viable tactic now is just an indication of the slight changes that have happened in between the different iterations. Now we see MSL again using that AK-47 that he captured after the shotgun headshot. He's going to pick up the frag. It's going to be Nico with a pistol kill to finish up the round. And we are going to see the defusal here. It's going to be an elementary one. Nobody can test that, of course, because they've shut down all the remaining members of Ninjas in Pyjamas. And now that's going to make the scoreline again more respectable yet again. 15-9 the current scoreline as the scoreline updates. There you go. So still game point here for Ninjas in Pyjamas. That's not going to change anytime soon, obviously. I do perceive them taking the victory here. I think 16-10, like we've already said numerous times, is a perfectly acceptable scoreline.
Yeah,
it allows the Nexus the confidence to go into Inferno and think, okay, well, that's the stronger map. We're better at Inferno than we are at Nuke, which is obviously evident.
Yeah.
We should play better here. Do you agree with that?
I totally agree with that. As I see Pim actually just kind of suiciding down there, doing a threat, really, doing 50 minus 50 HP on himself. But a Nexus just plowing through the NIP lineup here. It's all down to Fiflarin on 90 HP. He's up against four players from a Nexus. He has to go save his gun, really, doesn't he? Oh no, he's going to try to be a little bit of a hero, it seems, Jay.
Well, I mean, it's not like the shot of cash, and it is game point, obviously, T-side, so chance here for a miracle clutch, very unlikely, especially with that nade going in. Beautifully done from MSL. He had the right angle on the whole exit on the grenade, so does do enough damage to remove what health was remaining, though. And now we are seeing a scoreline of 15-10. So any points from any rounds from this point for Nexus, I think, are all gravy.
Yeah.
I think it's more than they probably would have expected, to be honest.
But to be fair, though, as well, like the last round now, Nexus clearly show that they can easily handle an IP team rushing them. And also, they're forced down on an eco now, NIP. So it's going to be at least 15-11, RJ.
I think this is the actual first time we've seen them on an eco in the second half here. So really, at this point now, this is where Nexus could rack up another round. You'd anticipate them doing so as you see the ramp sort of scouting mission going to fruition. It's going to lead to an M4 frag. MSL does know there's somebody up there. He's not able to get the angle to open up with the AK, though. And as you can see, top ladder being suppressed. That's going to be Nico down to 36 HP. Boris doing a great job with the somewhat OP Glock, but honestly, OP or not, still no match for AWP. There you go, just to prove my point, Nico picks up the frag onto Forrest, who was carrying the bomb as well, so that bomb is now in a very vulnerable position. It's going to be covered by the AWP and Nilly underneath. This should be an exit round here, as you see Nilly opening up the M4 frag onto Fiflarin. It's going to leave two members standing, Get Right and Exist. If anybody could clutch this with just pistols, it's going to be those two.
Oh,
leaping head Glock head burst shot. Yeah, I'm going to see Nilly with his... is that going to be his third kill, the round? It is going to be his third kill. He's going to have MSL for the backup as well. So another good round there for Nexus. An eco bash nonetheless, but they did the right things at the right times. Nico holding top ladder against Forrester's push outside, taking a lot of damage from the Glock. Showed a lot of balls there to actually face him. I mean, most people are intimidated by NIP to begin with. If you're going to take, you know, over 60 damage and then still face, I mean, I'm a big fan of that, because if he knew he had the positional advantage and he knew he had the weapon to do the job. Still, though, I think most teams would have backed out of that engagement and let Forrest sort of have a stroll around outside.
Yeah, but that's why one of the things I like with Nexus, like they doesn't afraid of anything, really. I mean, they got big balls. They got two balls, really.
Yeah, I'd say they got two giant balls.
Giant balls, really. They've put the Freiburg down to 21 HP already in this round, and Nexus keep impressing me, RJ.
Yeah, I was going to say 10 balls then, but 10 balls just sounds really weird, even though it would be, you know, factually correct because there are five of them. Then again, I haven't inspected all the guys.
Okay,
so.
All right. This is going a bit too far now, Jay. Let's head back into the game here. Let's get right. Tries to push onto that ramp, but Nilly shuts him down. Take it away, Jay.
Well, as you can see, a 5-on-4 advantage in favor of the CTs here. So NIP going to be pressing for the sort of leveling of the teams here. It's going to be hard to do with Frybro down to 21 HP, though, so... saying that, Nilly is down to 19, so if they do engage with each other, you'd probably expect Freiburg to get the best of it because he usually would be first on the trigger. Now, we are seeing the adjustments coming in. Looks like NAP are starting to shift over towards the lower site. Saying that, no, they're not. They're trying to get back up the vents, and it's just not going to work for them. So 15-12 now the scoreline, and... You know, there is a chance that we could see an overtime here.
Yeah, I mean, with this kind of play, wouldn't you kind of expect it?
Yeah, I mean, well, NIP have dropped off a little bit, so we're going to probably see another eco here from NIP. That would then push us to 15-13. We'll see a buy run coming off the back of this eco because obviously NIP aren't rocking an AWP in the setup. So, I mean, there is a chance that we would see a sort of 16-13 scoreline here, but... The way that we're seeing them play at the moment, as you can see, just being completely shut down on the outside rush here. That's not good. Yeah, most inopportune time for that to happen. It does seem like we are going to see... Basically, it was an eco bash run, so we're going to jump straight back in. I don't think we're going to miss too much here as long as the relay does come back up straight away. Let's talk about what we've seen so far, though. I mean, NIP dominant in the first half. They had a great start to the second half. They seem to have let up a little bit. Do you think that's... It's obviously not intentional, this level of play, but do you think that's sort of just them getting a bit too relaxed?